compositions of transformations and glide reflections, and 3 theorems. We're at 9.4 with 6 previous videos for Chapter 9 that you can find in the description in the geometry playlist if you're confused. A composition of transformations is one transformation followed by another. For example, a glide reflection is the composition of a translation and a reflection across a line parallel to the translation vector. We talked about vectors before. And remember, a translation is a transformation along a vector so that each segment joining a point and its image has the same length as the vector and is parallel to the vector. We talked about that in 9.2a and 9.2b. So if you look at this translation, we have a blue pre-image here, and we have our pink image. We can tell because this is ABC, and this is A prime, B prime, C prime. We have the length of our vector right here, and we can see that CB is parallel to the vector. Well, so is C prime, B prime. And the length of the vector here is the distance between C and C prime. It's also the distance between A and A prime and B prime. See that? Here we have a glide reflection. Here we have ABC, our blue one again. And our vector is this long. And it's going to translate so that A moves to this point, B moves this point, and C moves to this point. And then it reflects across line L so that we get A prime, B prime, C prime. That's a glide reflection. So here we have vector V. It's this long, and A translates to A prime, the distance of the vector. B translates to B prime, the distance of the vector. C to C prime, the distance of the vector. Then it's going to reflect across line L to get A prime, B, A double prime, B double prime, C double prime. And the image after each transformation is congruent to the previous image. By the transitive property of congruence, the final image is congruent to the pre-image with size and shape. But it doesn't have the same orientation, does it? See? These have the same orientation, but when it was reflected, it didn't. See? And that brings us to theorem 9.4.1. The composition of 2 isometries is an isometry. Remember, we learned back in 9.1a, an isometry is a transformation that doesn't change the size or shape of a figure, but the orientation might change. We can draw the result of the composition of isometries. If we're given that this is triangle ABC and this is line L, we have vector V that is this length. The first thing we do is draw our purple A prime, B prime, C prime, the reflection image, so it's reflecting across L. Then we can translate it the distance of vector V. So A prime to A double prime goes that distance, B prime to B double prime goes that distance, and C prime to C double prime goes that distance. So we had a reflection, then translation. We can find the final image, A double prime, B double prime, C double prime. Now we have a blue triangle, RST, that's going to be this one here, and it has vertices of R is at 1 and 2 for X and Y, S is at 1, 4, and T is at negative 3, 4, okay? I'm going to rotate this blue RST 90 degrees, it's a positive 90 degrees, about the origin, right here at 0, 0, and then we're going to reflect it across the Y-axis, see? So remember, it's positive 90 when we're going counterclockwise. It's negative 90 when we're going clockwise, okay? And the rotation image of xy is negative yx. We're going to use the inverse of the y value and then the x value. The x and y will swap places. So if we've got a 1, 2 for r, we're going to put for our x value the inverse of y. So y is a 2, so our new x, the inverse of y, is a negative 2, and then the 1 comes over and takes the place of where the y was. See? S is at a 1, 4. It's going to become a negative 4, 1. It's the inverse of the y, and then the x, see? Negative 3, 4 is going to be a negative 4, negative 3. And the reflection, because we're going to rotate then reflect, the reflection of image xy is negative xy. So we're going to do the inverse of x, and then y comes along for the ride. So now we've moved here, 90 degrees positive about the origin. Now we're going to reflect it across y. We're going to use this negative xy. So r prime, because that's where we're at now, we're on our second transformation, aren't we? So we're at r prime, s prime, t prime. So r prime is at negative 2, 1. We need the inverse of x. So if that's a negative 2, the inverse would be a positive 2 and then a 1. We have a negative 4, 1. The inverse would be a positive 4, 1. We have a negative 4, negative 3. We'd have a positive 4, negative 3 using the inverse of that x value. So now we've got it here. So rotation of xy is the inverse of y, then x. Reflection of xy is the inverse of x and then y. So now we're at another theorem, 9.4.2, which tells us the composition of two reflections across two parallel lines. So we've got two parallel lines. It's equivalent to a translation. Two reflections across two parallel lines equals a translation. And the translation vector is perpendicular to those lines. The length of the translation vector is twice the distance between the lines. So like if the distance between the lines is 10 centimeter between these lines, then the translation vector is 20 centimeters, okay? And if you just happened upon this video and you're not actually watching every video in the playlist, make sure that you don't miss 9.7b, because we're going to talk about the order of transformations and if they matter or not. So if we did a translation and then a rotation and our shape was in a certain quadrant of the coordinate plane, would it matter if we did the rotation and then the translation? Does it matter? Would it end up in the same place or a different place? And we're going to talk about that in 9.7b, so don't miss that, okay? So the next part of our theorem says the composition of two reflections across two intersecting lines is equivalent to a rotation. So here we've got these two black lines that are intersecting right here, and the center of rotation is the intersection of the lines. The angle of rotation is twice the measure of the angle formed by the lines. So this is a 40 degree angle, and we did a reflection and then another reflection, then the rotation would be an 80 degree rotation. See, it's twice this angle. And these two reflections across parallel lines had a translation vector that was twice the distance between these lines. So how can we apply this to art? Well, Emma is creating a design for an art project, and she reflects a figure across line L and then reflects the image across line M. So she's doing two reflections, isn't she? We need to describe a single transformation that moves the figure from its starting position to its final position. So if it says she reflected a figure across line L, what quadrant is the starting position? Well, if we started at 1 and she reflected across line L, we would have something here, wouldn't we? And we don't. So it's not starting here. If we started here, it could reflect across line L, but then it said it reflected across line M, and there's nothing here. So it must have started in quadrant 3, and it must be ending in quadrant 1. So if she started here, and she reflected it across line L, she was here. See, it flipped across line L. Then she reflected it across line M, and it flipped up this way, see? By theorem 9.4.2, the composition of two reflections across intersecting lines is equivalent to a rotation about the point of intersection. And since the lines are perpendicular, they form a 90 degree angle. So what happened was it started here, and instead of saying it reflected and reflected, we could say it rotated. See? So by theorem 9.4.2, the angle of rotation is 2 times 90 degrees, the measure of that angle, it's twice the measure, so that's 180 degree rotation. So we started with two reflections. So it was here, it reflected, then it reflected. We could also say it's a rotation and just say it rotated 180 degrees like that about the origin. See? So remember where each quadrant is located. It makes the shape of a C, as in coordinate plane or Cartesian plane. Starts at quadrant 1, makes the shape of a C going 2, 3, 4 around like that, and they're numbered counterclockwise with Roman numerals. In trigonometry, angles of rotation in the coordinate plane are measured counterclockwise from the positive x-axis. So if this is x and this is y for our x and y-axis, here's positive x to the right of the y-axis, isn't it? And we would measure this starting from the positive x-axis going this way, counterclockwise, so that would be a 60-degree angle measured going that way. Theorem 9.4.3 says any translation or rotation is equivalent to a composition of two reflections. So that's kind of flip-flopping what we saw in the other theorem. It said two reflections can be a translation or two reflections can be a rotation. Now it's saying translations and rotations can be two reflections. We can describe transformations in terms of reflections. We can copy each figure, so we've got ABC and A prime, B prime, C prime. We can copy each figure and draw two lines of reflection that produce an equivalent transformation. So we're going to do a translation of triangle ABC to triangle A prime, B prime, C prime. First thing we do is we draw segment A prime. And we locate the midpoint. We can mark it M for the midpoint of segment A prime. Then we draw the perpendicular bisectors of segment AM, so that would be P, and A prime M right here, that would be Q. And to draw the perpendicular bisector, you can use a ruler to locate the midpoint and then use a right angle to draw the perpendicular line. You don't need a compass, you could, but it would be quicker and easier to just use a ruler. So triangle ABC reflects across P, then reflects again across line Q. So this translation is two reflections. Here we have rotation with center P. We have triangle DEF, sorry about the focus there, and triangle D prime, E prime, F prime right here. So the first thing we do is draw angle DPD prime. So if this is our center of rotation, this P, we draw the angle from the corner of this triangle right here, D, to P to D prime. And we draw the angle bisector as PX. You can label them anything you want, but these are the labels that I used, okay? You could be PQ if you want or PS if you want. It doesn't matter. So now we've got this angle bisector here. Then what we do is we draw the bisectors of each of these angles. So you can see the green bisectors I drew. And triangle DEF, this blue one, reflected across ray PF. Here's PF. So it reflected across so that E was right here. Then it reflected across PX. So E prime ends up being right here. See? And this rotation is two reflections. So we can actually say it rotated. We can say it reflected twice. See? So our next lesson is going to be line of symmetry and rotational symmetry 9.5a. And we'll finish up that lesson with solids of revolution for 9.5b. Then we're going to get into 9.6 and 9.7. And then remember, 9.7b is the one that talks about the order of transformations. Okay, Once we're finished with these, we're going to get to chapter 10, talking about perimeter, circumference, area, apothems. Remember, everything is in the geometry playlist if you need it, and that's in the description. There's a link there. So I hope you were able to take notes, and I hope you were able to understand. This was kind of a long video. If you want to watch it a second time to completely get everything and maybe do take the notes that you missed the first time, remember my little yellow hands tell you the important notes and what to write for notes. So I hope you have a great day. I hope you're doing well, and I'll see you next time. Hit that like button for me. It really helps me out. Bye.